introduce this morning's session, let's bring up Mary Hauser, Vice President of Addiction Services and New Market Development for Dominion Diagnostics, and she's going to kick off our panel this morning. Mary?
Good morning. In 2014, the country watched as Ferguson, New York City, Cleveland, Los Angeles, and other cities across the country reacted to the deaths of Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Eric Garner, among others. During the sometimes violent protests, often lost in the national discussion, was the long-term effect of trauma on these communities. The National Conference on Addictive Disorders has organized an expert panel of local behavioral health care leaders to address these important issues and often neglected issues, and particularly to explore how individual behavioral health care providers can be a catalyst of healing for these communities when they come out of this kind of turmoil. To moderate the panel, I would like to bring back and introduce Gary Enos, editor, addiction professional. Gary?
I pretty much can guess that if you don't live in the state of Missouri, maybe about a year and or so ago, you probably had not heard of Ferguson, Missouri. Clearly you have since, and it's also probably pretty clear that your impressions and when that word is uttered to you are really shaped by what you've seen in national media coverage and sound bites, etc. Well, we're very fortunate and privileged today to have the perspective of local community leaders in our midst here who have an informed firsthand view of the events that took place, and most importantly, the effect that these events had on the community. And we've talked a lot at this conference about trauma and about trauma-informed care. And we hope that this session today will help us understand a little more about what the role of the behavioral health care provider can be in healing communities and in addressing some of these really pressing issues. So we really appreciate the participation and presence of our panel today. I'm going to introduce our panelists. We will do a full hour presentation this morning. Be thinking about your thoughts, comments, questions. We'll have probably somewhere around 15 minutes toward the end of the presentation for your feedback and your questions. So let me introduce our panelists for this morning. Dr. Marva Robinson is a licensed clinical psychologist practicing in St. Louis. She completed her master's and doctoral studies in clinical psychology at Nova Southeastern University, where she graduated with a specialization in forensics and a focus in child, adolescent, and family psychology. She started her private practice, Preston and Associates Psychology Firm, so she could have the freedom to reach families where they are. She is currently president of the St. Louis Association of Black Psychologists, where she has mobilized her chapter to address the community crisis sparked in Ferguson. Dr. Christi Griffin, founder and president of the Ethics Project. Christi Griffin is the author of Incarcerations in Black and White, The Subjugation of Black America, which explores the use of the criminal justice system as a form of economic exploitation. A retired attorney, she founded the award-winning organization, The Ethics Project, to address the impact of incarceration and injustice on children, families, and the community. Dr. Griffin has been recognized with numerous awards, including the President's Call to Service Award and the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Drum Major for Justice Award. Reverend F. Willis Johnson of Wellspring Church. With more than 15 years of professional ministry experience in Indiana, North Carolina, and Missouri, Reverend Johnson has developed faith-based social service initiatives addressing HIV/AIDS, domestic violence, and addiction. He has instituted a community-wide feeding program, and he has played a key role in the expansion of a prison ministry for juveniles and reentering adults. His writing credits include editorial content for the African American Lectionary, the Indianapolis Recorder, and Carolina Peacemaker. His essay and sermon, Get a Grip, is featured in a publication of Urban Ministries, and the National Baptist Convention profiled Johnson in its Young Voices, Fresh Perspectives in 2006. We're very happy to have our panelists here today. I want to start by giving our panelists an opportunity to talk a bit about the experience of Ferguson in the past year and what it tells us about the nature of trauma and its impact on a population. So if you could sort of introduce the topic in that fashion, and whoever would like to start.
I guess since I'm first in line, I'll go first. First of all, thank you all for coming out this morning, and thank you for the invitation and making this space for this type of a dialogue. We each saw our city change in a way that I don't think we were surprised by, but we're each saddened by the after effects of what we've seen. The reason why I say not necessarily surprised is because the dynamics of St. Louis in particular kind of has been a breeding ground for something like this to occur for quite some time. What I don't think enough attention had been paid to was the mental health effects of what would occur. The exacerbation of substance abuse disorders, the exacerbation of trauma, the failing grades for our children in school. And so our response has been about focusing on the healing of the mental health aspect. How do we address that? How do we reach students in schools? How do we make great partnerships with substance abuse facilities locally so that we can connect people to the type of care that they need? Because whenever you have a community trauma as large as what happened in Ferguson, we will be dealing with these behavioral health needs for decades to come. And so I'm so grateful to be here, and hopefully we'll be able to make connections with several facilities and practitioners in the audience so that we can strengthen the network that we're trying to build here for treatment.
Well, I would like to echo a thank you for being here and also an opportunity to have this conversation. It is very much needed. We really need psychologists and clinical therapists to be present and to be aware of the issues, not only those that are exemplified by what occurred in Ferguson and beyond, but what happens within the African American community on a daily basis. The trauma that is experienced in larger communities and other communities are those, as we're seeing just from yesterday, from the circus tent that collapsed and killed two individuals, a grandfather and his granddaughter, or as we heard on the conference call when we were planning this panel, apparently a tragedy that happened with an elevator that killed someone within a community. The trauma that happens within the African American community is one that evolves out of intentional acts from other individuals, which brings with it itself an additional impact. And it's something that as African Americans, we wake up and experience on a daily basis. So it's very important that our conversation this hour is spent in a manner that we raise awareness of the need for this particular community to recognize that this is a different conversation, that while trauma impacts everyone differently, there is a unique way that it broadly impacts the African American community. I was present in Ferguson the day after Michael Brown was killed, when the protesters began sitting outside of the police station. We were having a prayer vigil with a number of ministers who eventually became the guiding force and the spiritual lead of the protests. And then we met with the police chief immediately afterwards. And I have never experienced trying to speak with someone, those who were sitting in the seat and blocking the street, blocking not only the four-lane street, but also the entrance to the police station. And they absolutely did not see me. They did not hear. They did not want to hear anything other than, we are going to create a change. They've experienced the trauma that we have now seen displayed throughout this entire country. The scab has been torn off of a wound that has been festering for many years. And I appreciate you being here, and I hope that you gain something from this time that we're going to spend together, and that we'll be able to, as a country, begin to heal those wounds.
Well, good morning to you and to these dear sisters and women of the struggle here in St. Louis. Everything that they have said is not only right on point, but they, in their very deep humility, reference that they have, since its earliest stages, been present and accounted for and have helped to shape a lot of not only the conversation but the constructive work that has gone into rehabilitating, working towards rehabilitating and restoring both trust and strength in the young men and women, the mothers and fathers of both Ferguson and its surrounding municipalities in the larger region of St. Louis. I'm just an old preacher, all I did, I happened to live in Ferguson. Our church is in Ferguson, and the police station sits, is the halfway point between our personal residence and our church campus. On August 9th, that evening, hearing a great bit of noise and remonstration, I left by the leading and the encouragement of my wife to figure out what the noise was, to go out and see what was happening. I quickly came back and prepared myself, put on my running shoes, and not my clergy garb, but my jeans and a t-shirt, and we went to work. We went to work just being present. I wish I could say I was as pious as Dr. Griffin. I had not prayed before going out there. I didn't pray very much in the midst of being out there, some 3.5, almost 4 hours that would follow as we tried to, in the earliest stages, navigate and negotiate a little bit for these young people to have their voices heard, because they were not going to leave out of that, from that police station on August 9th, that evening, until they talked to somebody and somebody heard them. I think it's important to remember that they wanted to be and have continually desired to be listened to. We then spent much of that next day, August the 10th, Sunday, out of our respective corners and practices, beginning to engage the very crisis that was heaped upon us. And I'll be honest, the first thing that I realized, and I think any of us who are in the helping ministries or services have to remember, that we don't know everything, but we do know somebody. And the first somebody I called, once again, I'll be honest with you, it was not the prayer line, but it was one of my members who happens to be a clinical psychologist. And I called my dear sister and I said, I need you at church first thing in the morning, before we have worship and before we do Sunday school and all the stuff that plays church. I want us to be there, because come early in the morning, some hurt people, some angry people, some pissed off people, some mad people are gonna need somebody to help them and listen to them. And so that began our work, and that began our exercise of helping and hopefully guiding as we go forward from here, having the sanctuary and the street and the Socratic, or in this case, the social worker, converge in one place and begin to help the hurt and heal the pain.
Dr. Robinson, you mentioned in your opening comments that there were certainly some immediate and longer term effects in terms of behavioral health issues that in the population, school issues. Can you talk a little bit more about what was seen and how soon after the events this started to come to light? And maybe a little bit, we'll talk to the others also about the response of the behavioral health community locally here and how you would evaluate that.
Thank you for the question. I saw was an upfront personal seat at a community unraveling, at a community grieving, at a group of young individuals having early onset acute stress disorder, you know, having flashbacks of previous traumatizing events that came flooding forward, not only dealing with a community pain, but also having to understand that these were individuals that had lives even before this. You know, there was one young woman who had recently lost a child. There was another individual who just buried his grandfather. And so you're dealing with not only the immediate crisis, but understanding that what you're seeing is also some other grief and trauma come to the forefront. And so I think the difference with the community trauma is that it highlights all of those individual pains. And there's a layer of the community pain. And so it's this great, massive stuff that you're trying to navigate and deal with. And so the tricky role of as a psychologist is to validate and to hear it and not try to minimize it. Because the first thing, if you tell someone to calm down or to, you know, stop yelling, you only heighten the anger. And so a part of our response was, one, being culturally competent. We are all trained in Black psychology, urban psychology. We all had the expertise in knowing how to navigate and join this sort of a community pain. And so we leaned on our training first. We made no assumption that just because we had degrees that we were professionals, that we had the answers. So we were diligent in aligning ourselves and being welcomed into the community first, joining that invitation, and then being in the foreground to say that we are here to help if you need it, because you certainly don't want to push anything on anyone when they are that raw. And so in being invited into the community, aligning ourselves with other community agencies like Better Family Life, we were seen as a trusted source. And so what we did immediately the day after, as you know, the Reverend said, he called at 5 a.m. that Sunday morning, and we were just there, doors open. And so starting that Monday morning, every morning we joined alliance with local communities that were also invited into the community space. And we just offered services to those who needed it. We engaged the community. We offered short-term intervention skills for parents who didn't know what to do with their children. Because mind you, we're having conversations with parents who have 6 and 7 year old children that were sleeping in the closet on the floor, because the noise of flash bombs and smoke bombs kept them up at night. So you had children wetting the bed, children sleeping on the floor in closets because they didn't know what was going on. You had parents that felt helpless because they had children that were hurting and they didn't know how to console them. So we were there to kind of offer some short-term immediate tips that were culturally appropriate. We gave out different items to help assist them in using these coping skills. We held free and open listening circles. We came back day after day, and we were there whenever they were needed. We offered pro bono services. We made our website available to those who needed it. And so that was kind of our immediate behavioral health response. And we went to Canfield, which was kind of like the ground zero, every day around 8 a.m. until about 6 p.m. for the first 3 weeks straight, including weekends. And so if we were contacted by other mental health professionals that wanted to help, we kind of had this discussion about what's the best way for different individuals to assist without it being a hindrance, but also being helpful. And so that was great to get some support, but that was our immediate response. And so we also have a long-term plan that we have these listening groups called Emotional Emancipation Circles that we offer free of charge to the community. And so that's been our long-term plan. But it certainly is a very active a very active work that our chapter is involved in, and we don't see it diminishing anytime soon.
Other thoughts about the response of the behavioral health community in general over the past year to, if either of the other panelists have any thoughts
about it? Well, yeah.
I would encourage for us to see it as an interdependent or interdisciplinary relationship. Most of us have to be honest, and I don't know if we have clergy in the room, and I definitely respect faith-based perspective in counseling. I am not an expert in everything. And we tend to have in some of our extending circles or supportive circles of counseling and those kind of things, I'll be honest with you, and you probably already know this, you know, what they tell you in seminary or the counseling classes you take in seminary is enough to get you in trouble. Okay. And as much as I believe in the power of the doctrine and of not only my faith tradition, but particularly the church or tribal connection that I'm a part of in United Methodism, you know, there's some stuff that you can't just pray away. Okay, prayer and work, prayer and, you know, a prescription go hand in hand. That's how we teach and encourage. So what we did, or what we seek to do in being support in services, is not try to hoard it or control it, but create the space for it and engage and echo what was happening on the street or in the conversations. Those circles of conversation, some of them, not all of them, but many have taken place in our physical space. We sought to provide resource to supporting, whether it was the chapters of professional ranks that were counseling or doing other things, or simply encouraging families, particularly in the African-American community, because we do have a history, at least, of practice of engaging and applying our faith in crisis to help people understand that talking to someone other than the pastor is not only what you need to do, it's what you ought to do. Okay, I love my clergy brothers and sisters, but this, there are people, there are men and women who you dedicate yourself and you have understanding in applying and adapting and being available to do this over a longer period of time in more intensive ways. So I hope that you, I guess my point was that I hope that you don't see your work in isolation and see your relationships in isolation, and be willing to leave the couch in the confines of your space and begin to engage in this particular instance at the street level or in the sanctuary. But this is such an interdisciplinary exercise and a cross community, across cultural exercise. And that's what I hope that we've begin to model, because that was not, has not been a strong asset or dimension to behavioral sciences or clinical science work here in this region.
I would like to add first, I want to commend both of my panelists because they have been so present from the very beginning. I reached out to Reverend Johnson early on to do some nonviolent training in his church, and he immediately opened his door and made that possible, as he did for many other community organizations. And then Dr. Robinson has just been tremendously available. Anything I have asked, she has not only provided her own services, but has even brought in people from out of state who volunteered their services and came in to provide that. And she has been that responsive each time I've asked. So I just want to commend both of them for their generosity and their sensitivity to their own community. I would also like to say that even before Michael Brown was killed, and this was brought to the forefront, in my role as a board member for the St. Louis Initiative to Reduce Violence, I was working with the superintendent of the St. Louis Public Schools to provide trauma-informed training for teachers within the St. Louis Public Schools, and also had both the police chief for St. Louis County and St. Louis City to agree to have trauma-informed training, additional trauma-informed training for their officers. And this predated Michael Brown being killed and what you're seeing evolve from that. And again, that is because that trauma existed before Michael Brown was killed. The protests evolved, not because, and it just ironically, I went to the parking lot of what was considered ground zero here in St. Louis, where all of the military vehicles were being kept and the police officers had their command station. And as I got out of my car, a young white couple were getting out of their car and we started talking. And they actually believed that this was about the killing of Michael Brown. They had no idea that these were festering wounds and problems that existed within this community for decades and finally came to a head because not only was he so brazenly killed, but that his body was left lying on the ground for 4.5 hours as a message to the community in much the same way that black bodies were lynched and left hanging as a message to the community in the 30s and 40s. But this was a problem that we were trying to address early on. And one of the things that I would ask you to consider is the problem that we faced is that the psychological community that I reached out to, particularly in trying to identify black psychologists who were trauma-informed, could not find any who were qualified. They were willing to be paid very well by the St. Louis public school system to provide services, willing to be paid very well by the city of St. Louis in St. Louis County. They have been largely absent, from my view, in what has been occurring on the streets. They have not provided the types of services at no cost, as Dr. Robinson has done, and all of the psychologists that she has brought to the table. And at the same time, we're unable to find qualified black psychologists who were trauma-informed. That is a problem. It exemplifies broadly what continues to be an issue within our country. And simply put, it's the same racism and oppression that created the problem in Ferguson or brought it to our attention in the first place. So we have to change our thinking, not simply about trauma, but simply about how we treat other human beings and see other human beings and are concerned about a broader community, not just those who look like you, not just those that live next door to you, that go to church with you, where your children attend school, but to see the humanity in every human being and understand the trauma that has been inflicted on this community. I would also like to give you an assignment to read the comments of newspaper articles that has anything to do with Michael Brown, with Ferguson, with Baltimore, with Eric Garner. Because another irony is that just as I was in the process of working on this issue when things came to a head, I was also, ironically, sitting with a group of those pastors who were the protest leaders and many of the protest leaders, some who later sat down with President Obama to address this issue, with Common, who you may know of as being the author and the singer or the rap artist from the movie Selma, singing Glory. And we were with him and taking just a short period of time to sit back and watch the movie Selma and to have a discussion. And there are so many issues and so much continually happened that in the midst of that movie, while we were already going through the pain of seeing the similarities between what occurred in Selma and the tear gas being used and the brutality being used 50 years ago in Selma, that we were experiencing the same exact trauma in Ferguson. And while we sat there, both in that pain, but at the same time feeling a sense of relief that we had a moment to literally just sit down and to be with people in a different atmosphere, and cell phones began to light up. And even in that moment, we could not have a moment of relief. The Eric Garner grand jury decision came back, and I have never felt such pain and such frustration. And tears began to flow, and one by one, the pastors began to leave to join the protesters downtown. Just across the hall, many of you may have eaten here in the Grand Station Grill. I held a breakfast and brought together some of those pastors and protest leaders with the chief of police and the head of, at the time, the Missouri Department of Security, and with Ron Johnson, who was the head of Unified Forces that many of you saw leading the protest response. And in the midst of that, cell phones began to light up, and one by one they had to leave. That was the day that the memorial burned. This is the same type of non-stop pain and trauma that African Americans face every single day. And despite the fact that there are African Americans within this field, as exemplified each time I've picked up the phone to Dr. Robinson, for some reason, when I call them to bring them into the St. Louis public school system and into our police departments, none could be found. And that's fairly true in about just every other industry. We seldom can find a qualified African American to head a company, to be a police chief, to sell cars, to be a part of the management staff. Those are the types of problems that create this whole cyclical issue of abuse that brings on trauma, of incarcerations that bring on trauma, of physical maladies that bring on trauma. If we don't begin to be honest and have these open conversations, nothing that we do and nothing that we say is going to change anything.
I want to stick with that. There are obviously, these events don't happen in a vacuum, as you very articulately expressed. And I want to get a sense from the panel of how can individual behavioral health providers, addiction mental health providers, et cetera, possibly serve as, you know, catalysts for change in communities like Ferguson and other communities around the country. Is thoughts about, you know, how should they be involved and how should they be involved?
If I could take that one first, Dr. Griffith gave a homework assignment, so I'd like to follow up on this same thing with knowing that this is the National Conference on Addiction Disorders. For the providers in the room, if you can just ask yourself, or when you go back to your place of work, ponder these questions. How culturally competent is our relapse prevention curriculum? How diverse is our staff? How diverse is our leadership? I think the work starts with each individual company and practice with challenging yourself to be culturally competent and first acknowledging that if that is a shortcoming, reaching out to others that can help build up that aspect. It matters for individuals when you go for residential treatment or methadone treatment and you can't get a counselor who understands what your plight is like. They can speak to you about the curriculum in a robotic form, but not understanding the driving forces culturally that brought you to the place that you are. It would have been great to be able to find a addiction facility that would have reached out to us or that I would have had access to in a part of this work. If an individual would have come to me and said, you know, we may not be comfortable going out to a protest or just canvassing a neighborhood, and I would never recommend that, because if you're not comfortable with it, don't do it. But then reach out to another behavioral health group that is comfortable doing and align yourselves with them. Because what I would have done is reached out several times. I was called to work with a group of protesters who were very active. They would be out 17 hours a day. And trauma has a way of increasing the rates of substance abuse. That's a research fact. And sure enough, one of the members in this group relapsed because the stress was so so much that he gave in to his addiction. Well, he had previously been in a facility that if you miss two methadone treatments or something like that, you are asked to leave. And so this individual wanted to be on the front lines, wanted to make sure that the message of justice was heard, but also struggling with the heroin addiction. So if a facility would not have been comfortable being a part of their protest, at least aligning themselves with the St. Louis Association of Black Psychologists, it would have been great to say, hey, I have this individual who's looking for help or for treatment, can I refer them to you? And so that's kind of how the work starts. Acknowledging that, you know, our facility may need to do some work in growing with cultural competency, and then reaching out to other agencies that have that strong suit so that we can start to align and work together. That's my recommendation.
One of the things that we did over the course of the last year was hold what we call mother-to-mother conversations, and that was bringing together a group of 9 African-American mothers to speak to audiences of predominantly white mothers about the conversation that every one of us has with our sons about driving while black and walking while black, and the confrontations that will occur, not might, but will occur in their lifetime. Ironically, I never asked, as I reached out to each of these mothers, I never asked one of them, did you have the conversation? My question was, will you come and speak about your conversation? I had no doubt they had the conversation. And in fact, there was hesitation when I called one mother that surprised me, because I'm used to people just immediately giving me a yes, and she hesitated, and I couldn't understand why. And she asked if she could call me back. And she called me back a few days later and, of course, agreed that she would. The reason she hesitated was because she had to go back and ask her sons, do you remember me having these conversations with you? And their response was, of course, Mom, all the time. But it's such a common part of being an African-American mother that she did it rotely, that she didn't even recall doing it. It is a part of her DNA. But during those conversations, that same mother posed to the audiences, we have, and we held these all over St. Louis for a number of months until literally we were just emotionally spent. But she finally posed the question, what conversations are you having with your sons who grow up to be judges, who grow up to be police officers, who grow up to be prosecutors? And that's the same conversation that I pose to you. What conversations are you having in your own homes as individuals, with your coworkers, in your communities, in your children's schools, at the PTA meetings, that will guide this country in a different direction? How much time do you spend in considering the pain and trauma that has been inflicted on the African-American community for over 400 years? there has been a continuum. It has never stopped. That is the subject of the book that I wrote, The Subjugation of Black America. There has been a continuum of changing from slavery to various forms of oppression. What are you doing to change that? And the reason I asked you, I didn't fully explain the homework assignment, thank you for reminding me, but if you read those commentaries, you will see the depth of hatred and ignorance that proliferates our society in every one of them.
I think in the next several days, probably the national news crews are going to return, and we have an anniversary upon us. And I want to give the panel an opportunity with its local perspective to assess where is this community now. Maybe Reverend Johnson, you could start, because a year has passed and you're in the heart of the situation. Where is the community in terms of healing, in terms of where we go from here before we get the national perspective in the coming days?
Well, it's in process. I mean, this didn't happen overnight. I think everything that you've heard, that this is historical, of historical consequence. It has been heightened, and there's triggers and stimuli that are natural to the very systems that make up community and living. And so this is for some people very innate or imprinted either behavior or responses. Life has progressed, but depending on who you talk to and where they're at, change or transformation is relative. We have done a lot of things that are, aesthetic and correct or obvious, but the systems haven't changed. Okay, the systems have not changed. The message has not changed. The demo, I don't know what, respectfully, I don't know what you would expect a year from now. I mean, until you live something like this, I mean, I'll give you something trivial. We had a back to school activity yesterday and a health fair and all that good stuff at the church. Usual thing that you do. And we said, oh man, they've been here for 4 hours. They need to feed the volunteers. So somebody came to me and said, Pastor Johnson, where can we order some pizza? And I had to think about it for a second. I was like, and my initial response, I was like, I can't order Little Caesars because that's still burned down.
A year later,
still can't get no pizza, pizza. Thank you. Y'all just too serious in here. I mean, I've been up
really?
Since 5. I mean, I'm sorry. This is my third interview and all that good stuff, so I apologize. But, I mean, a lot, I'm sure, has changed. Much of it is invisible even to us.
Yes. Yeah.
One last little personal bit. 2 weeks before Ferguson, I got married. You just clapping because you didn't pay for it. That's all. You wouldn't have been clapping if I sent you the bill. But anyway, my wife and I, we got married July 19th, went on honeymoon for a week, came back. She lived out in a little West County community called Creve Coeur. Had no desire to want to move to Ferguson anyway. All right. She's a school teacher, moved her in. Usual stuff. She went to go get her school ready, and that next weekend, Ferguson happened. Now, any of you who have ever started anything new, moved, getting married, either have children or inherit new children, all those things, get a new job, aren't those the usual kind of standard triggers for trauma, stress, anxiety? Imagine all of that happening in a week. In a week. And then have in your mind, it's not the same. And so for every veteran that's in here, no, I know people are sensitive about using the term PTSD and all this. We can all be sensitive about our context. But for my wife, this is as close as she's going to get to military life, with me being on assignment and itinerant as a minister. To see all of that happening in your life, and then your husband gets deployed. Yes, just down the street and around the corner, but your husband gets deployed. That's just my story. And we have ways and means and degrees out the wazoo and all kind of stuff at my house. Imagine someone who has none of these things. And even a year later, what has changed is not the things that the media is going to talk about. Yeah. We are forever changed. We are adapting and trying to experience in our own home, in our own church, in our own community every day, what will be normal. And so for this week, we're back to the normalcy of everybody being voyeurs into our lives. I know that doesn't feel good, but what is changing is that hopefully you leave here and you recognize not what you haven't done well or what you haven't done at all, but what you realize you recognize and realize the work you still have to do.
Yeah.
And look to join up with men and women and organizations and resources that will empower you to do that at a higher level.
I would like to add something.
Sure.
I just ran across an article about Darren Wilson. And on Saturday, my charge is to update the community on the progress of various laws that have been proposed and enacted in the last year. But for this group in particular, I think raising the awareness of where Darren Wilson is conveys a message that I would like to leave you with. And that is how deeply affected his life is. And it has very little to do, obviously, with the criminal justice system. We respond so quickly by wanting to incarcerate people for every infraction there is. And yet with Darren Wilson, who was not indicted, and personally and as an organization, we filed the bar complaint against the prosecutor because there was gross misconduct. Regardless of what the outcome could have been or would have been or should have been during that grand jury proceeding, there was gross misconduct on the part of the prosecutor that is still being swept under the rug, and we are not going away. But Darren Wilson was not indicted. He was not put into the criminal justice system. There, at this point, is not going to be a trial. And yet his entire life has been deeply affected. He wants to continue to be a police officer and has applied for several jobs. And each of them have determined that he is too much of a liability. Darren Wilson will never be a police officer again. He is, in fact, a liability. His family's life has changed. He also is a newlywed. His relationship with his wife, and I'm sure what she thought her life was going to be, is very different because of that one decision. And my point is that no matter how much You ignore race in your practice. No matter how much this country tries to minimize the existence of African Americans in this country, to wipe clean the slate, you of all people should know that there is an effect that you cannot escape. If you don't begin to embrace what has been inflicted on the African American community systemically and historically, you will continue to see your children act out. You will continue to see your children being suicidal. You will continue to see your children driving while under the influence. I don't know about your community, but here in St. Louis, there are far more white children in our county and rural communities who are killed in car accidents. These problems are going to continue to creep into your communities, and you can move further and further and further away, and they will follow you wherever you go. So I invite you to understand, again, of any profession, you should be aware that what you saw happen in Ferguson, what you saw happen in Baltimore, in New York, and in other communities that don't reach the national news is nothing but a problem that has been festering for years, and I guarantee you is not going away.
I'm interested in the Q&A part of this, so I will make my comments very, very brief. The things that I've seen that have grown out of this is the voice and the presence of the LGBTQ community, in particular the Black LGBTQ community, and also the presence of the interfaith community as well, making the space for these individuals who have been a huge push in the Black Lives Matter movement. So that has been a change that I've seen. Systems have not changed. I've mentioned that we give services pro bono. We have, from the beginning, not only individual therapy, group therapy, community workshops. Some of our chapter members are in the audience, but it's all been pro bono. And that's not because we beg to give away free services, but when you say systems do not change, there's been millions of dollars poured into Ferguson to help with relief fund and mental health services. My organization has not seen a bit of that. And so that kind of speaks to when you say people want to put on media that there is this outpour of resources and funding, the greater systems haven't changed. How much our politicians in Missouri talk about this has not changed. And where they choose to put their financial funding for the behavioral health for the community that's most impacted has not changed.
Please join me in thanking this great panel today.